Hi, I'm Rob Bowman, the Chief Technologist for High Reliability. If you want to know more about TI's space products after this video, please visit ti.com/space. Thanks for watching. And in this lecture, we'll be talking about total ionizing dose effects on bipolar junction transistors. We've seen this diagram before, but I'll go through it for those of you who haven't seen the earlier videos. This is a band structure of an MOS device, a metal oxide semiconductor device. So the horizontal axis is the vertical axis, the real physical axis of the device. We've got the gate on the left-hand side, the oxide in the middle, this is the insulating layer, and then finally the silicon substrate on the right. The vertical axis denotes energy, and in this case, electron potential energy. So as the electron moves up on the diagram, it's gaining potential energy. As it moves down, it's losing potential energy. The effect of radiation in the total ionizing dose mechanism is that when the gate oxide is exposed to radiation, any energy absorbed in the gate oxide produces electron hole pairs. So basically, an electron absorbs the radiation energy, so it gains energy, it moves up on this chart, leaving a hole behind. Now, one feature of gate oxide which makes them problematic for total dose is that the mobility, or the ease with which the carriers move in the gate oxide, is different for the electrons and holes. In fact, the electrons are fairly mobile and can be moved readily with an electric field, which we show here. We have a positive gate voltage which brings the electron energy down and is attractive to the electrons, so any electrons in the conduction band up here that get excited by absorbed radiation will travel very quickly down through the gate oxide and into the gate, again attracted by the positive gate voltage. Whereas the holes that they leave behind that are less mobile will hop slowly through the valence band towards the interface. Again, they're being repelled by the positive gate voltage. Holes are positive. Another feature of hole hopping transport is that since it disturbs the local crystal structure, much of which, particularly in gate oxides, contains protons or ionized hydrogen, when the hole passes near a hydrogen site, very frequently the hydrogen is freed by the presence of the hole. And so now you have a situation where you have holes moving by a hopping mechanism, and as they hop, they actually release hydrogen ions or proton into the gate oxide. And of course, since we have an electric field in this example, the positive charge on the gate is going to push both the holes and the positively charged protons towards the interface. Now, the holes get trapped in so-called deep hole trapping centers, which are near the interface, and deep in the sense that they're in the middle of the band gap. So they're somewhere between the conduction band edge and the valence edge, right in the middle. So there's a lot of energy to get them there. It takes a lot of energy to get them into the conduction band. So any holes that end up here pretty much stay here or are very hard to move. So this is basically charge trapping of holes close to the silicon. And of course, this much positive charge close to the silicon will have some effects, as we'll see, particularly for the bipolar devices. The other feature of the proton release and transport is that protons actually interact in a different way in the oxide. They basically move to the interface. So this is the silicon to silicon dioxide interface right here. And because of differences in the atomic structure, you get so-called defect states or surface states created here. Now, they're usually modified by the protons, and this can create a positive, a negative, or a neutral trapping center right at the surface. These will affect carrier concentrations and carrier lifetimes, which we will see has a big impact on bipolar junction devices. Okay, so on the left-hand side, I show a cross-section through a lateral bipolar device. We have the collector region out here, a narrow base region, at least in this part it's narrow, over here it's fairly wide, and then the emitter base depletion region is right here. So emitter, base, and collector. Now, what happens when we collect this positive charge and we get the interface states, we can get either inversion regions after irradiation, or we just get carrier trapping regions. And so carrier trapping affects the recombination rate, increases the recombination rate of electrons and holes. What that means is any carriers injected into the base, a portion of those will basically start recombining or disappear at the interface. So what this means is you've got a base current which is proportional to the surface recombination rate. The presence of defects increases the surface recombination rate, which then increases the base current. The problem with this, of course, is you're not getting an increase in collector current. So the external circuit has to force a lot more base current to get the same collector current out. Effectively, your HFE or the beta of your bipolar transistor is going down because now you have to produce a lot more base current or inject a lot more base current to make up for the surface recombination effect caused by these defects, by the total dose effect. And we can see here on the right-hand side that as a function of total dose, as we increase the total ionizing dose, so more and more radiation, basically that base current is going up. And again, this is a log scale. So going from a total dose of 10 krad to 100 krad, we go up about 50x base current. So again, if the base current goes up by 50x, that means your bipolar transistor gain is going to go down significantly as total ionizing dose increases. Now, one thing to be aware of is that the total dose effect in bipolar transistors is very frequently dose rate sensitive. In other words, the rate at which the radiation is put on the device changes the sensitivity of the device. And it's a little bit counterintuitive because at lower dose rates, you actually get an enhanced effect. And hence we call this the enhanced low dose rate sensitivity. The reason this is bad is because when we do an accelerated test, we want to use as high a dose rate as possible so that we can get the total dose that we're after in a very short period of time. The bad news is because of Elder's sensitivity, and this is particularly a problem for bipolar junction transistors, because of the Elder's sensitivity, we have to be very careful. In other words, we have to determine, does this bipolar technology have an Elder's sensitivity? Because if it does, we cannot use high dose rate testing. We have to use extremely low dose rate testing to validate what the worst case device shift will be. On the left-hand side, I show a bunch of different PNP and NPN devices. These are discrete devices, but they show you kind of as a function of dose rate. So the horizontal axis here is dose rate. Vertical axis is relative damage. This could be beta degradation. This could be increase in base current. But it's a relative metric. And what I show down here are devices that are dose independent. Okay, so there's no Elder's sensitivity. And this is basically what you would expect is a flat line. In other words, independent of the dose rate, I get the same value. The relative damage here is 1. This one also, it has a flat region, but as you get to the higher dose rates, you actually start tapering off. And you'll note the normalized damage actually goes down at the higher dose rates. Again, this is a problem because we want to be operating at a very high dose rate, get the test over with quickly, but then we'll underestimate the actual damage at the lower dose rates. And then these last two devices are very sensitive, and in fact it's, you know, almost a linear relationship here, or log linear, as a function of dose. So this is kind of proof of concept. On the right-hand side, I'm showing basically why this is a problem. Here I have a line derived experimentally for an LM124 op amp. At 10 rads per second, we show the input bias current. Again, that's going to increase with time as we increase the total dose. Horizontal axis is total dose. So it's increasing slowly with time. If we stop the test there and said, okay, we've characterized the device, we know it's going to shift, you know, from 10 to say 20 nanoamps, and maybe that's acceptable for our design case. And then someone says, no, wait, let's test the Elders as well, or the extremely low dose rate. So we do another test on a similar device, but now at 0.01 rads per second instead of 10 rads per second. Okay, so at a much lower dose rate, though, we're seeing a much larger increase in base current. And just to keep things, you know, in mind, this is for a spacecraft application or satellite application. The dose varies over time. As we stated in another lecture, depending on the orbit and which radiation belts you may or may not go through, you're going to have a different dose depending over time, basically. But the key point is this spacecraft dose is much closer to the low dose condition than the high dose condition. So if you were to test bipolar transistors only under high dose conditions, you would get the wrong answer and you would underestimate the damage. So this would be very bad. Your system would probably fail. So just key point here is in bipolar transistors, some transistor types or technologies, the total dose effects can be worse at low dose rate. And in fact, you have to test at low dose rate to see if you have a dose rate sensitivity. Okay, so I mentioned it's kind of counterintuitive. There's still a lot of argument in the industry as to what the problem is and how it's caused. But one of the kind of ongoing theories about this is that it has to do with the fact that you're both creating and transporting holes as well as proton release. And the holes and the protons have different mobilities. They also occupy different trap states at the interface. And so the theory is at low dose rate, you have a few electron hole pairs. So you have some positive hole trapping and you get proton release, as we mentioned, from the movement of holes through the gate oxide. Now, because it's just a small amount of hole trapping, there's not enough positive potential here from the hole trapping to push away the protons. So the protons still make it to the interface. And as we said, the interface defects control the recombination time, which then causes the increase in base current of the bipolar junction transistors. In the case of high dose rate, in the bottom picture here, we create a tremendous amount of electrons that are trapped immediately. And the theory, according to these authors, is that you get an electrostatic potential that basically disables the proton. So the protons are still released by the process of the hole hopping, but the protons can't get to the interface. So you're basically blocking the protons in the high dose rate, and hence the damage caused by the protons is not in evidence during the test. And this may be one reason why the high dose rate tests in bipolars will often hide a low dose rate effect. One other thing, since we know that hydrogen is involved with this, one thing that you might expect is that if you could make a semiconductor process with no hydrogen or very little hydrogen versus one that has a lot of hydrogen, you should see a difference in dose rate sensitivity. And indeed you do. In this paper, we show the squares with nitride and the circles are no nitride. And nitride in this case, this is silicon nitride, and it's typically deposited with a hydrogen-rich process. So in a case where you have nitrides, again, the squares, you can have a lot of hydrogen embedded in your process. So if this proton release mechanism is kind of a key to the base current rising, you would expect in a nitride process with a lot of hydrogen, you would have more total dose effect. And sure enough, this data shows you in no nitride, it's almost total dose independent. There's not much change in the input bias current or the base current over dose. So again, horizontal axis here is total dose, total ionizing dose. And then for these two other components here, which are with nitride, you see a very large difference as a function of dose. And you see an Elder's effect or an extremely low dose rate sensitivity because the gray squares are nitride at a high dose rate. So again, it's underestimating the actual damage or increase in base current. With the low dose rate, we see a very large increase in base current when nitride is present. So no nitride equals much less hydrogen. So we expect in a no nitride process or one that doesn't really have much hydrogen, it will have less of a low dose rate sensitivity. Okay, so what is the impact of total ionizing dose, to summarize, on bipolar junction devices? Trapped holes, which is basically positive charge, and interface defects created by protons affect surface carrier concentrations. This is a big effect for potentially MOSFETs, and carrier lifetime, which, as we saw in this case, is a big effect since it affects the recombination rate, is directly linked to the base current that you need to get a certain collector current. Basically, an increase in the recombination rate means an increase in the base current, which means your beta goes down. So total ionizing dose induced carrier lifetime reduction in the base forces the external circuit to provide more base current for a given collector current. So thus, beta, or your HFE, of the bipolar device is degraded over time as a function of the total ionizing dose. One thing to be aware of is that bipolar junction transistors with more base area near the surface oxide are going to be a lot more sensitive to total dose. So this means that typically lateral BJTs are much more sensitive than vertical BJTs. Thank you for your attention.